card having different symbols to represent it in a ER diagram. So to represent any strong and weak set, we are going to use, see this first symbol, it is a rectangle, right? Single rectangle to represent strong entity set. To represent weak entity set, we are going to use double rectangle. To represent the relationship set between two strong entities, we are going to use single diamond. To represent a relationship that exists between a strong entity and a weak entity, we are going to use this double diamond. It is a relationship between strong entity and weak entity. We are going to use double diamond. Now, ellipse with solid line is basically used for primary key. Simple ellipse is used for attribute, simple attribute. Double ellipse is used for representing multi-value attribute. Dotted ellipse, we are going to use it to show derived attribute. To show the total participation in between relationship set and the entity set, we are going to show it by double line. An attribute with dotted line is basically used to show the partial key in the weak entity, or it is also called as discriminating attribute in weak entity set. Then there are different mapping cardinality constraints that we have to show, that is one to one, one to many, many to one, and many to many. So if this is the symbol given to you, it is basically used for representing many to many relationship. Lines, there are no arrows on both the sides, it is many to many. If you see this next diagram, it is used for showing many to one relationship, because on the right hand side there is an arrow, but on the left hand side there is no arrow, so it is many to one relationship. To represent one to one relationship, we have to show arrow on both the sides, left hand side of the relationship set as well as right hand side of the relationship set. To show the role in the ER diagram, we draw a line with a name, or you can say label lines are basically used for representing roles in the ER diagram. To represent specialization and generalization in ER diagram, we are going to use this triangle labeled by ISA. Okay, so these are basic few symbols we are going to use to design the ER diagram. Now coming back to the designing process of an ER diagram, if a problem statement is given to you, like design an ER diagram for a banking system, what comes to your mind first? Tell me, what comes to your mind first if somebody tells you to design an ER diagram for banking system? So how the banking
account
system
function functions? Branch, account section, manager, branch.
Yes. Please write in the chat box. I'll read it from that. All of you, please write your opinion in the chat box. If someone asks you to design an ER diagram for a banking system, what comes to you? What comes to your mind first? That is, first thing is branch information, accounts, loan department. Very good. Different types of accounts in the bank. Customers. You forgot customers. Customers are very important component of a bank. Shreya has mentioned it. Very good. So first important thing before designing any ER diagram is to identify the entity set. So I'm writing here the steps. Identify the entity sets. All possible entity sets you need to identify. Maybe a strong entity set or maybe a weak entity set. Including weak entity set. So you are going to identify all the entity sets, means the rectangles in the ER diagram, or you can say the master tables, master table as well as slave table when you convert it into a relational model, right? So here, if you see this particular diagram, it is designed in a reference book which is representing the bank database system, banking database system. So what is important in this diagram is the rectangles. Now identify which are the important rectangles here. Employees of the bank, customers of the bank, then coming to the account of the bank, different loans of the bank, different branches of the bank, then in between loan and the branch, the relationship, there is one more entity state is there, that is called as payment. Payment is related to the loan entity set. So it is weak entity set. We already studied what is strong entity and weak entity. And in this example, we have covered in our previous session. Then in accounts, there are further different types of accounts, saving account, checking account, right? So different types of accounts are represented by this specialization. So first we are going to note down, the first step is that we need to going to note down all the entity sets, possible entity sets for the given problem statements. So here, what you're going to write in the first step for banking system, first is employees. Second is customers of the bank. Third, accounts. Fourth, branch information. Fifth, loan information, loan entity. Said. If loan is there, definitely payment should be there for every loan. Payment entity set, but this will be a weak entity set. Right here, it would be a weak entity set. Yes, these are certain possible entity sets. Anything missed, students? These are important components of the bank: employees, customers, accounts, branch, and then loan and its payment. After identifying the entity sets, what is the next step? Identify all attributes of each entity set. So if I consider, say, employees, what are the possible attributes? Please write in the chat box for employees what you want to record in the database. So all those attributes should be there in the employee table. Yes, what are the different attributes should be there in the employee table? The first important attribute is employee ID. Every employee must be assigned an ID, which is the primary key for that particular entity set. And then other attributes, name, their dependent, age, date of joining, and many more, right? So like that, you can find out all the possible attributes and you can write in front of it. So employees, I'm writing here one example. For employee, entity set, I can say employee ID, comma, employee name, address of the employee, then email ID if you want, right? Then date of joining, DOJ, date of joining, etc. You can add many more attributes as per your need. So this is the second step in designing the ER diagram. In first step, we identified all the entity sets. In second step, our job is to find out all the attributes for each and every entity set. Likewise, you need to find out attributes of customers, accounts, branch, loan, and payment. Third important step is now we need to connect two entity sets via a relationship set. It means that here in third step, I need to identify the relationship that exists between two entity sets. Two entity sets, right? For example, I'm writing here in between customers and accounts. Suppose customer is one entity set, another entity set is account. There is a depositor. Relationship set, or there is a depositor relationship in between customer and account entity sets. It is because customer deposits amount in the account. So depositor is the relationship between customer and account. Likewise, you have to pick any two entities out of these available entities. You have to relate each entity with other entity set via relationship set. Take another example of customer and loan. So what would be the relationship between customer and loan? It would be borrower. Borrower is the relationship between customer and loan, and so on. So this is our third step in designing the ER diagram. Fourth important step is, after this, join the entity set to relationship set and entity set to attributes via lines. So these are four steps. Join each entity set to the relationship set and each entity set to all the attributes of that entity set via lines. Fifth important step is, show the mapping cardinality constraints. Mapping cardinality constraints. In between different entity sets. So this is our next step, that is, show the mapping cardinality constraints in between different entity sets. So these are some steps we are going to follow to design the ER diagram. Anything missed or I left out, students? I have covered strong entities, weak entities, then attributes, then relationship set between two entities, then the lines which joins the entity set to the relationship set, and then entity sets to the attributes. After that, the mapping ratio or mapping cardinality constraints between entity sets. So these five important steps we need to follow while designing any ER diagram mentioned in the reference book, that is on banking system. I have already uploaded this PDF on your Google Classroom. If this PDF is not visible to you, you can download it on your machine. Let me focus on the different strong entities available in this. Can you please write what are different strong entities available into this diagram before I explain? What are different strong entities are there in this diagram? An entity which has a primary key is called strong entity. So which are those strong entities here? You write your answer in the chat box. Okay, I'll show you the diagram. From this you can write. Okay, so here we are given some answers. Let me read. The first one is branch is a strong entity. Customer, account, loan, employee, all these are strong entities. Give the example of weak entity in the ER diagram. Which is the weak entity here in this diagram? An entity which does not have sufficient attributes to form the primary key of a relation is called weak entity set, and it is always represented by double rectangle in the ER diagram. So which is the weak entity here in this diagram? Payment. Yes, many of you have given the correct answer. It is payment entity set. Primary entity is the weak entity set because it does not have sufficient attributes to form the primary key. Now coming to the strong entities like customer, we'll take the example of customer, and we put all the attributes of the customer entity set into the ellipse, like customer ID, customer name, customer state, customer city. All these attributes we put it into the ellipse, and we identify the primary key out of these four attributes. We have to decide which is the primary key of this customer table, and we identified that customer ID is a column that can be made as a primary key of this particular entity set. So we represent customer ID by the solid line, because all the primary keys of any entity sets or any entity sets in this ER diagram are represented by ellipse with solid line. Now take the example of employee. Take the example of second entity set, that is employee. All the attributes like employee ID, employee name, telephone number, start date, maybe our join start date means joining date, employee length, dependence on employee, maybe employee wife, the children, they are dependent on employee. So there are many. That's why it is represented by this dependent name attribute is represented by double ellipse. What is multiple attribute? Any attribute which takes multiple values for the same record. It is called multi-value. So that's why dependent name is multi-value attribute here. Then employee experience or employee length. Length means experience of the employee can be generated from the start date of the employee. So it is represented by dotted ellipse. So it is a derived attribute of this particular entity sets. Take another example of strong entity, that is branch. Here on top, if you see, there is a branch. Has three attributes: branch name, branch city, and branch assets. So we can say branch name can be a primary key of this. So we represent it by solid line. Take the example of another entity set, strong entity set, that is loan. Loan number and amount. Loan number can be made as a primary key of this table. Take the example of account entity set. There are two attributes: account number and balance. From this, account number can be made as a primary key. Now, further dividing this account into several types of accounts, we use specialization to show it. So we represent a triangle ISA. Below that, we have saving account and checking account. Definitely, saving account is different than the checking account, or you can say current account. In saving account, you get interest rate, whereas in current account, you don't get it. You have another attribute, that is overdraft amount here. So there is a difference between saving account and checking account. So we identified all the strong entities, and for that we have drawn all the attributes of it. Then now we have to focus on weak entity set. Now take this example. Here is payment is a weak entity set having the three attributes: payment number, payment date, and payment amount. The relationship that exists between this strong entity and weak entity is represented by double diamond. So, and the name is given as loan payment. In the third step, we have to identify the relationship set for each and every participating entities. So you, how do you going to identify which is the relationship that exists between two entity sets? You pick randomly two entity sets from the several entity sets that you identified. So consider this example. Pick employee and customer. Suppose these two entity sets you pick. What should be the relationship between customers of the bank and employees of the bank? Customer banker relationship, right? Customer banker is the relationship between customer employees and the customer. Then if you take next entity set, like customer entity set and account entity set, what should be the relationship between these two? Depositor, customer deposits money into the bank, right? Then you can say account and branch. What should be the relationship? It is branch has accounts, you can say. Branch has, HS has is the relationship. If nothing has come to your mind, you can write the names of both the participating entities and combine that name, account branch or branch accounts, as the relationship. That is also a valid relationship name for these two entity sets. Now let's see the example again. We have covered strong entities, attributes, weak entity and their representation. We are also seeing how to represent this this diamond, all the relationship set. Now coming to the roles in ER diagram, just focus on the entity employee which related to the works on relationship set, and there are two lines joining this. It means this employee is works on employee, employee works on employee. It means there are many workers who works for the single manager. It is an entity which is relating to itself, self-referential entity, you can say. So it is represented by the labeled lines, all the roles of the entity which it plays into the relationship set. It is represented by labeled lines. So this way we can write. Now one more important point is, sometimes it happens that we must have some extra attribute in the relationship table, relationship set. So in the depositor we have access date, we have access date. In the employees and the customers, there is a customer banker relationship. Type of employee, maybe a manager or clerk or any other type, or you can put it here. What type of relationship? That relationship should be explicitly mentioned here in the type. Okay. So at last, we need to make sure that all the entity sets, all the relationship set, they are joined via lines. After joining the lines, you have to apply the last step, that is mapping cardinality ratio. After joining all these lines, you have to focus on the mapping cardinality ratio between two entities. What are different cardinality ratios that happens in between two entities? It may be one to one, one to many, many to one, or many to many. Let's see the diagram. See, one employee handles many customers, so there is one arrow on the employee side. Similarly, one manager manages many workers, so for this particular line there is an arrow towards employee side. If you see on the loan table and payment table, for each payment of the bank there is a loan number assigned. So one loan for payments, so one arrow towards loan side. One branch has many types of loans, one branch has many types of loans, so one arrow towards branch side. One branch can have many types of accounts, so you must show arrow towards a branch entity set, because one branch many accounts, and rest of the things you keep it as it is because there is many to many relationship between them. Okay, so you have to identify which are the mapping cardinality ratio between two entity sets. So this is our last step in designing the ER diagram.